Emotions Matter, brought to you by EMAW.com. That's EMAWW.com. Your solution for emotional intelligence. Welcome to the Emotions Matter podcast. We're excited to bring you Steve Ozanich on this episode. Steve Ozanich is a mind-body health consultant, health coach, and author who penned the two-time International Book Award honoree, The Great Pain Deception, and Dr. John Sarno's Top 10 Healing Discoveries based on his own experience, the work of John E. Sarno, MD, and 10 years of intensive research. His third book, Back Pain Permanent Healing, Understanding the Myths, Lies, and Confusion, is a three-year writing effort to pull the larger picture of suffering together and to erase the confusion regarding healing. Over the past 17 years, Ozanich has helped to teach thousands of people how to heal themselves through his lectures, books, articles, and interviews. He's available for consultation at steveozanich.com. Welcome, Steve. It's great to have you with us.
Thank you, John, for the opportunity to spread this great message.
Excellent, excellent. So I tell you, your personal history indicates that you've healed from more than 30 years of pain. If you don't mind, give our listeners some insight into your experience and what that process was.
Sure. I started having severe back pain in my teens, along with other pains too, because they're all basically serving the same purpose. But my main symptom was back pain, and it just was relentless. I had tried everything. I had acupuncture and, you know, hundreds of chiropractic adjustments and physical therapy. And in the late 1990s, it just got worse. It's so bad that I couldn't walk anymore. I'd lost 54 pounds at one point, and I was crawling around the floor, and I was a couple weeks away from a surgical consult. And a friend of mine introduced me to the work of a doctor from New York University Medical Center. And I read this article, and it was talking about how back pain never comes from the structure of the spine, that it comes from an oxygen flow loss through the autonomic nervous system. And at first I didn't believe it. I thought it was just crazy. But as I got worse, desperation breeds open minds, right?
Right.
And so I bought his book. It was called Healing Back Pain. And I am now 18 years pain-free. And I've just spent the last 15 years writing three books on the process myself. And they've helped tens of thousands of people to heal also.
That's an amazing story. So you spent a lot of time doing research after you healed. So what really was your focus? What was your process for all of your research?
Sure. It was to focus on this process, which is called TMS, which stands for the mind-body syndrome now. It's actually it has actually evolved through the years. When I first read this doctor's work, his name was Dr. John Sarno. It was called tension myositis syndrome. But when he realized it affects more than just muscle, he switched that acronym to tension myoneural syndrome for muscles and nerves and tendons. But towards the end of his career, when he realized that tension affects everything, all the way to the immune system even, and the skin and everything, that has morphed into the mind-body syndrome. But TMS is still the correct acronym for that. And so all three of my books are based on this doctor's work, Dr. John Sarno, on this topic of TMS.
So since you're a TMS mind-body health consultant, could you explain briefly what the total TMS package is, and really how did you learn the method?
Okay, this is a big question. It's actually a very controversial topic, because people believe that when they have symptoms or pains or whatever it is, that it's the body problem, when it is not. I mean, he proved this, but he worked for 50 years, five decades at NYU. And there's several people like me doing the same work. And it's obvious it is almost never coming from the body, whether it's foot pain, hand pain, knee pain, shoulder pain. all of these things. And so the brain is trying to distract us when we get overwhelmed by emotions. And of course, they're all unconscious, so we're not aware of them, which is one reason people don't want to believe it either, but it still holds true. And so the brain is doing its best to attack certain areas of the body, like a herniated disc or arthritis in the knee or the shoulder or whatever. And it's doing that to help you cope. You obsess on your physical body and away from the emotions that are too threatening, too powerful, or too sad. And so by doing things like surgery and injections and manipulations and physical therapy and strengthening and stretching and stabbing and cutting and poking, that is exactly what your brain hopes. It wants you to obsess on the physical body and away from these threatening emotions. And so actually doing things like the medical industry does is the problem. It's the reason that there are epidemics everywhere. Back pain has now become the number one cause of disability in the world because it's not coming from the spine. And so what I do is to tell people to get away from that stuff. Stop doing the surgery. Stop doing the therapy. Stop doing the injections. Stop doing the manipulations, because that you're playing right into your brain's grand strategy when you do that. It's hoping. And of course, it's not working. We have the most advanced techniques and technology in the history of humankind, and every epidemic is getting worse. They're not getting better. Wow. Because we're focusing on fixing a body that does not need fixed. You know, everybody has these natural normal changes of, you know, this bone on bone diagnosis that they're giving is crippling people. But when they get into the TMS work, they begin to heal. And so the part of the controversy comes from two sources. And my method, you know, is to do nothing. And so the medical industry doesn't want to hear that, because that's their profit, right? That's right. Their cash cow. And the people actually do not want to hear it either, because the brain is protecting them. That's why it's forcing the symptoms to the body. It's creating a symptom hoping that you will obsess on the body. And so it's protecting them from very, very powerful things. And of course, we always use the paragon of examples of this comes from Dr. Sarno's work. And I put this example in all three of my books. And we call her Helen. She was a lady, I guess, that was bedridden for several years. She couldn't get out of bed from the severe pain. Her family heard about Dr. Sarno in Manhattan at NYU and got him up there to see him. And under intense psychotherapy, she had remembered being molested by her father when she was 5 years old. Hmm. She was 47 at this time, so 42 years. And so they sent her to incest support group, and she got worse and worse and worse. And so she called Dr. Sarno back. She said, "Dr. Sarno, I believe you. I believe this is TMS. I believe this is the cause for the diversion, but I'm not getting better." And the woman's husband said at that moment, "You're talking about 42 years of repression here." And something in those words that he told her turned a key in her mind, and she just lost it. She collapsed. She fell on the ground and she was shaking and she was crying, "I want to die. I want to die. I want to die. Let me die." She thought she was going to have a heart attack. And within minutes, the pain was all gone completely. And so Dr. Sarno said, "Okay, I see what's going on here. The pain is protecting us. It is protecting us from aspects of ourselves that we don't want to see, that we've repressed outside of our conscious awareness." And so he ran with that hypothesis the rest of his career, and it proved to be true. It held true every time. So it's unconscious, and you will never know about it. Everybody that came into his office wanted to do the Helen experience, you know, reach in, pull these things out, and make my health perfect. But it doesn't work. That was the only time he had ever seen the unconscious break through to consciousness. So we have to get through to the people through the conscious mind. And we do that through education. And so that's a long way around to answer your question. But I'm a teacher. I educate people on what's happening between mind and body. And then they reflect on themselves. They begin to see themselves differently. They begin to see what's going on and to stop chasing these red herrings in the body itself and work on their emotional life. And they virtually all heal. And I say virtually because it's very rare that somebody doesn't heal. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there are some severe cases of child abuse, you know, that they're very tough to get through. The emotions are just so full of rage and fear and anger. So this is a new paradigm in thinking that Dr. Sarno brought to the world. And it's deserving of a Nobel Prize in medicine. And I am one of those messengers of this great movement.
you spoke a lot about Helen and some emotions, some deeply embedded emotions that were basically transforming themselves mentally or in from the brain into this pain. Do you have some categories of emotions that actually derive into or manifest into specific sorts of physical ailments? You know, you mentioned a few other things earlier. Give us some examples of the emotions and what those things manifest into in what you found on your research. And some of the, you know, you've got a fabulous wall of success. And so I'm assuming you've seen a lot of different emotions manifest themselves into specific pain. Can you give our listeners, some examples of some of those?
Yes. All of our health problems come from fear. That's the root cause. Fear is darkness. Fear is ignorance and not knowing. It's the opposite of love. A lot of people believe that hate is the opposite of love, but it is not the opposite of love. Fear is the opposite of love. And so this problem, as you would imagine, begins in childhood. It doesn't suddenly appear as an adult. Usually these people can trace their health problems back to childhood. And it's one of perfectionism, because our greatest fear as a child is always being abandoned, being left, nothingness. The child's always anxious, always afraid that the parents are fighting, or if a parent dies or the parents divorce, that they're going to be alone. It's that simple. And that causes amazing fear, because love is a connection, this warmth of light, knowing that you're safe, and this great feeling of happiness. The opposite of that is fear, which is darkness. And so this personality, now this is not a health problem that we have. It is a personality issue. It's one of worry and perfectionism and trying to make people happy all the way into adulthood so that they never get rejected again. That's a number one goal in everyday life, is to avoid rejection. And because when we're rejected, we're alone one more time. And so this personality that Dr. Sarno noted very early on was one of goodism, he called it. They were nice. They were always trying to take care of everybody, make sure everybody was happy. But there's something deeply enraging about that to people. When they're being nice and they're being perfect, the deeper psyche hates that. It actually despises it. And so anger then is the result of the fear. As Dr. Sarno described it, anger is the social reaction to overcoming the source of the fear. That's a good definition for it. Because anybody knows, if you see a little kid almost runs out and gets hit by traffic, you know, what's the first thing the parent does after hugging the child? They start yelling at them, right? Because they were scared right there. And anger is the effect of fear. And so you often hear that anger is the main issue in all of the pains and the ulcers and the migraines and the skin problems. That's true, but it really starts with fear. And of course, people will feel anxiety. What anxiety is anger that is not expressed. And we have anger. Everybody has some level of anger. We need some anger to function. And we would just be blobs laying around if we didn't have some conflict within us to get up and motivate us to do something. And so, but when this anger builds and builds and builds, and yet there's no way to express it through talking to somebody or with journaling or dancing or painting or whatever, it comes out in the form of anxiety. Mm-hmm. And it's really amazing to watch this process, because people have extreme anxiety one second, and the next second their knee will lock up and they won't be able to walk, and the anxiety disappears. And then the knee pain goes away and the anxiety comes back. And so what's happening is the brain's trying to help you not experience these threatening emotions of fear and rage and anxiety. These sensations are too horrific to the brain. So it tries to, for some reason, we don't know why, it prefers physical pain. And so it will often attack something like a herniated disc in the back. Okay, now it's in the back. We've got a back pain. Now we've got a series of errors that occurs. They go to the doctor. They get an MRI and they say, oh, it's herniated. There it is. We'll cut that out. Okay? Well, it doesn't work. I mean, there's been many studies show that it doesn't work at all. Hmm. And yet people think that it does because of something called the placebo, of course, which is another topic. But once they operated on it, like Tiger Woods, he's a great example right now. I was doing a live radio show out of Lansing, Michigan, and I told him that Tiger's back surgery won't work. And it didn't. He had to pull out of that tournament again a couple months ago. It's not coming from the structure of the spine. But if the person believes it, in deep belief, the brain will shift to another area, like the knee or the shoulder or whatever, into some other form, in what Dr. Sarno called the symptom imperative phenomenon, which that is, I think, his greatest discovery right there. Mm-hmm. People have all these health problems, and they think they have multiple health problems, but it's only one issue. It's the brain desperately trying to divert those emotions to the body. And so it's just a brilliant discovery, and it works virtually every single time.
Incredible. You mentioned personality a little while ago, and I noted some things in some of your interviews that you've done. You talk about the different personality types. Can you give our listeners a little bit of insight into those personality types and how you describe them and how they manifest themselves into bodily pain?
Sure. I've just written an article on this recently too. I called it the pain personality, but that's because that's the one I'm most comfortable with from my own experience, which we call a type T personality, by the way. T stands for tension. There's a certain type of person that we call the type T that suffers chronic symptoms at a higher degree, at a higher level, whether it's skin or stomach or sleeplessness or anxiety. And they're the warriors. They're the perfectionists. They're the goodists. They're the people trying to make everybody happy around them. They're the ones who are trying to avoid conflict all the time. And for some reason, this is just deeply enraging to have to pretend. Really, it's about pretending to be something other than you really are. And so they suffer higher pain thresholds and higher pain problems. And then, of course, in the 1960s, the medical icons Rosenman and Friedman, those two cardiologists, identified a personality type called the type A. And after they published that paper, they became medical icons because they noted that these people, this certain personality suffers higher heart problems. And actually was one of their secretaries in the office. She had noticed that they sat on the edges of their chairs more often. They looked at their watch constantly. They wore out the arms on the chairs because they were holding on to them so hard. Right. And this type A, it's similar to the type T in some ways, but not at all in other ways, because the type A is very outward and very vocal and expressive and complaining all the time, where the type T would tend to be quiet. Mm. And so Dr. Sarno had noted, and he practiced for 5 decades, so he saw quite a few people, probably more people than any doctor in American history, if you think about it. But he noted that the type T did not have very many heart problems. It was very rare. Mm-hmm. It can happen, of course, but it was very rare. And the type A, they suffered quite a few heart problems. But there's also, I think in the 1950s, there was a guy named Lawrence Lachan who noted a cancer personality, which we call type C. And they were what we like to call type T on steroids. You know, it's an old phrase, but they will even go as far as apologizing to their friends and family for getting sick because they don't want to burden them. And so it could be just variations, you know, to magnitudes, certain magnitudes, I don't know. But for some reason, certain people are more prone to certain types of problems. Mm-hmm.
So in your first book, The Great Pain Deception, it won 2 awards in the International Book Award Contest, and it's got almost 300 great reviews on Amazon. Previously to this, you've been discussing the conflict between modern medicine and what's actually occurring in the body. What are the most astounding findings that you've experienced through this, you know, the last decade or so of your research and experiences, et cetera, in some of the people that you've counseled? What are the most amazing things you've seen?
Wow, that's a big question. That is a great question. I've seen so much in 20 years. That's why I started that wall of victory on YouTube, the TMS Healing Wall of Victory. I wanted to show people, wow, look at what's happening here. These people are healing from cancers and MS, and they were in wheelchairs. They couldn't walk anymore, like I was having trouble with, and now they're running marathons, and they're fine. And I'm consulting with people around the world. Dr. Sarno's work has spread to every country. Norway, Sweden, New Zealand, Australia, Singapore, it doesn't matter. They're all healing. And the question is always the same thing. How come no one knows about this, Steve? Really, how come nobody knows about it? It's because, like I said when we first started, the people don't want to hear it, and the medical industry doesn't want to hear it. Mm. And the message does get blocked quite a bit. But there is a film coming out soon. It's going to come out in June on Dr. Sarno called All the Rage. And I think it's premiering in L.A. and Arizona and New York and Chicago at first. But it's got all these stars in it. You know, Howard Stern, Larry David, the guy who created Seinfeld, professional athletes, HBO producers. They were all crippled. And now they're fine. Senator Tom Harkin, the former senator from Iowa, he was in pain about the same number of years I was, 27, 28, 29 years. And he found Dr. Sarno's work and healed. And they convened a panel in the Senate called you know, Pain in America. And he held Dr. Sarno's books up to all these pain experts. And he said, how come no one's looking at this? And they just stared at him because they don't want to. I mean, it's basically saying that what you've been doing is not only not working, you're actually harming people. And there's nobody who practices medicine that wants to hear that. Well, I shouldn't say nobody. I don't want to throw a wide blanket across. There are actually doctors that contact me and they'll say, wow, your book changed my life. And now I've incorporated it into my practice. Even some of my strongest allies now are chiropractors who no longer manipulate people. They talk to them about what's going on in their lives. And so that question you ask, it's big. You know, there's so much happening. There's so much happening. Like just recently, I've had two people who were crippled pretty badly read my new book, Back Pain Permanent Healing, and they ran marathons and they sent me pictures of them holding the medals up, which was really meaningful to me. It was really beautiful. And so, I mean, this is the motivation. I mean, this is it, is to see people get better.
So let me ask you something. As you work through a process with the people you are coaching and mentoring, walk us through a standard sort of, maybe it's a Q&A, or how do you actually work through these issues with people as they're trying to deal with a significant pain in their body, and it's coming from something internal? Is it a psychological conversation, or is it something else? How do you actually work through these things with folks?
Yes, it's different with everybody, of course, because everyone's at a different level of awareness.
Right.
It's awareness that heals, not doing things to the body. Mm-hmm. And it sounds crazy, but that's it. You know, and the truth will set you free. That was just a great line, a very great line, thousands of years old. So some people, they're new to it. Well, let's go back a little bit further. Some people are fortunate. They can read the book and heal from many, many years of pain. Dr. Sarno estimated about 10%, 10 to 20% of them. I would say that's about right in my experience as well. They'll read my book. They weren't able to walk, and then they're running. Mm-hmm. And but some people, I would say most people in that 60% category, they need a little bit more work, more confidence that it's not a physical problem, because erasing doubt that it is a physical problem is part of the process. That's the healing process, is to become more aware and more aware and more aware that it's not a body problem, and you begin to heal from that. And so they'll call me or they'll hire me for a consultation, and I'll listen to their words. Mm-hmm. There's no cookie cutter method to doing this. You just can't say do X, Y, and Z and you'll be fine, which of course everybody would love. Well, we do have a method like that. It's called taking a pill, right? That's called taking a pill.
Right.
Just if people can blame it on the physical body, if they can say, well, I've got one leg longer than the other, I've got one hip with arthritis, or I've got herniated discs there or whatever, then that allows them to escape responsibility for their life. They can say, hey, it's my body. My parents had it, or it's genetic and all that, but it isn't. Mm-hmm. It's all virtually every single time. It's an emotional process. But remember, it's unconscious. You'll never feel it. You know, if people say, well, I can feel my anger. Well, that anger has nothing to do with your symptom. If you feel it, it's experienced. It's released from your body. It can't hurt you anymore. It's what you cannot feel, like Helen. And so I will listen to their words. And if they're asking things about body and TMS, I know that they're very beginning stages. The people that don't understand the process very well are still talking about body. They're still talking about body consciousness, mm-hmm, instead of life. The ones who really get it, they begin talking to me about their family, you know. And I would say, like, a typical email that I receive is, you know, Steve, my mother died, and I'm in getting my master's degree, and my husband and I are getting divorced or whatever. Mm-hmm. This whole domino effect of things. And because repression is an automatic tool, we don't even know it's happening. It's building in them and building in them, and the tension's building, and they're not even aware of it, and bam, All of a sudden, a disease or a pain blindsides them and they're knocked down. And so the people that understand it more, they'll start talking about, you know, their life, how they react to life, how they don't react to life. Those are the good consultations. And I will listen to what they say. And I'll say to them, well, look how what you're saying here. And they'll think about their words and how they're seeing it, because it's about shifting their awareness of what's going on and how they're reacting to life. That is the healing mechanism. And you can say that's light. You know, fear is darkness. We're shedding light, which is the opposite. Light is love. We're shedding that onto the darkness. And that is the healing mechanism. It's been around for thousands and thousands of years, of course. The great prophets told us this, but we got into techno medicine, of course, in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s. And we decided, well, we'll just engineer this body. You know, we're smarter than nature. But really, the only thing that can heal you is you. The body is a natural healer. Now, I also want to say this. We have to be smart here and responsible with our lives. Mm-hmm. You have to get a checkup. We have to make sure there's not a malignant process happening there, or like an aneurysm. I've seen that in the spine that's caused back pain. So be responsible. Make sure that you're cleared of danger before you try TMS healing. Mm-hmm. And once your doctor says, hey, you know, it's just, you know, the body problems, you can ignore that advice as long as you're safe. And so and then there are some people that contact me that I can tell immediately need intense psychological counseling because they were severely abandoned or abused children, and they've had crippling health problems, and they can't stop crying when they're talking to me. And so I send them to a psychotherapist, because I'm not a therapist or a doctor. I can't diagnose it, and I don't do family counseling. I'm an expert in TMS healing. Mm-hmm. Some people will say, Steve, what do? You know, you're not a doctor or a therapist. I used to answer it by telling them, did you ever see the movie Pulp Fiction? You know, that the Harvey Keitel character, the wolf, mm-hmm. You know, he cleaned up the messes. that was basically what I was doing. But, you know, I really am a teacher. I'm educating people on this. I'm showing them who they are, really. And when they see themselves as they really are, what's really going on in their health, they begin to heal.
You mentioned a couple of your clients. And your third book is called Back Pain, Permanent Healing, Myths, Lies, and Confusion. Share some more feedback from your readers that means really a lot to you and really gives you the energy to keep doing what you're doing.
Yes, and it's virtually every day, you know, not quite every day, but almost every day I get a story that someone healed from either my book or Dr. Sarno's book or a combination of both of those. And it really is the motivation to keep going. If it wasn't working, we wouldn't be doing this work, but it works almost every single time. And like I said a few minutes ago, the two marathon runners recently, that was just really very rewarding to hear. I was very pleased. And they'll be going up on that wall of victory soon too. But, you know, one that stands out is the guy who healed from stage 4 cancer. He wrote me an email that rocked me. I mean, I was shaking looking at this email, just telling me how beautiful the work was and that my book was the best work he had ever read. And we laughed because he had the same name as me. And he was a chiropractor, actually. Mm-hmm. And he said, I see the world differently now. You know, he was able to see it, look right at it and see it and shift his perception. And, of course, there are literally tens of thousands of people healed with my first book, because it's been out 5 years already. Mm-hmm. But each one of those stories is really meaningful. And I think the ones that really mean a lot to me are when the kids heal, the parents will contact me and they'll say, we just want to thank you. We took our child to doctor after doctor after doctor, flying from state to state to state. And, of course, every doctor you go to, you get a new diagnosis. No, this is too long. No, this is too short. No, this is too high. This is too old. And it's not coming from the body. You know, it's not coming from there. And so they keep looking, just like trying to pick up mercury. The problem just keeps getting pushed around. And if the person believes that it worked, it'll shift into another form, like sleeplessness or anxiety again. And so when they'll say, you know, our child is well again, it's back in school, that's really, really powerful. And so, you know, we could talk for months on the examples. It's really fun. I was actually thinking about writing a book on the examples alone because it was so powerful. But you'll see on that wall of victory, the one girl named Anna, that was a beautiful testimonial. People really liked that. She had tried everything. She said she was dying at one point. They were diagnosed with vasculitis at one point, which is what Harold Ramis died from. If you remember the producer, Harold Ramis from Ghostbusters. Mm-hmm. And her ANA markers were high for autoimmune, and she had lost all kinds of weight. She thought it was the food. She had been restricting certain foods. And then she found Dr. Sarno's work, and she got a little bit better. And then she found my book, and she healed. And on that testimonial, that is really a beautiful testimonial. She cried a couple of times on there about how the work saved her life. And so every day, I really enjoy it. And I really want to thank you, too, for giving me the opportunity to tell people. If just one person believes what we're talking about here in Hills, it was worth you and I doing this.
And that's exactly what we're trying to accomplish here. You know, it's funny, even one of our listeners, we got a question from one of our listeners. Her name is Lindsay. She's about 25 years old. She's from London. And I know what the environment is in London. It's fast paced, et cetera. And she wants to know, you know, it's pretty general. She wants to know if there's a way to heal her body through her mind. She's been really suffering with a lot of great back pain. And really, for her, no therapy has helped her so far. Give her an idea what her first step should be.
Well, first step is get checked out to make sure there's nothing dangerous there. You know, we need to make sure that you're safe. Your life is the most important thing here. Protect it first. So we want to make sure there's not a malignant process. We want to make sure that there's no bleeding or anything like that, or an infection, I guess. But the weird thing is, too, the brain will actually attack broken bones that healed, that had a crack in them at one time. John Stossel was one of those people. He did a special on Dr. Sarno, on Dr. Sarno's work called Dr. Sarno's Cure in 1999. And in one session with Dr. Sarno, his 20 years of back pain disappeared in one session. Mm. And he said, but it was in my vertebrae was cracked. Huh. And Dr. Sarno said, that's a normal abnormality. The brain uses, and yet another really Nobel Prize winning observation, he noticed that the brain would attack certain sites of changes like arthritis or cracks or herniations. And the doctors would think, well, that's where it's coming from, but it isn't in what's called a spurious correlation. A spurious correlation is a false correlation. It's just associated with the symptom being the cause. That is not it. It's not the body. And so she needs to get checked out first, of course. And then we call the TMS diagnosis one of exclusion. In other words, we can't observe it directly, like on an imaging, like an X-ray or an MRI. We can't say, oh, there you got TMS. There's a marker there on the imaging. We have to rule out danger and then start talking to the person. If she can find her way to a TMS physician, unfortunately, there isn't any in England. They're all in America. He trained a couple dozen of them here in America. But she needs to start talking to someone and finding out whether she has the personality type. You know, does she fit the type T? What's her health history looked like? See, the TMS physicians start looking for red flags. Mm-hmm. You know, and if you just had someone die, like I said, or you're getting your master's or your doctorate, and all these things, red flag after red flag after red flag goes up after the end of a 1.5 hour to 2 hour visit. These sessions last about 2 hours with these TMS physicians, and then they will come to the conclusion: you've got this. You've got this TMS. And that's a great diagnosis because now she has a chance to heal. And so they'll most likely be given Dr. Sarno's book and my books, and then they'll go home and they'll read them, mm-hmm. and they'll see how they fit. And one of the most common statements is, I read myself on every page of your book. You know, when I describe myself and the other people that I've worked with and the personality type, they see themselves. Ah, yeah, that's me. I think the same way. The same thing happened to me. And then they have to accept it. Mm-hmm. You know, I can give them all the information in the world, and it won't work if they don't accept it. And Dr. Sarno would say to people, he would see that they had TMS, and he would say, can you accept the fact that that break or that herniation and that arthritis is not causing your pain? And that 80% or so would say, no, I can't. I saw the images. I can't. I believe it's from that. And they would go suffer. But about 20% would say, yes, I can see that. I could understand that. They would virtually all heal. And so she needs to accept it after she's been cleared and read the material. And that book should be enough, really. It should be enough. But if it isn't, then you find somebody who, you know, is an expert in consulting like I am. And there are some of those in England. And so, so there's some work to do.
Excellent approach. So, Steve, what's next for you? Maybe another book, or why don't you give our listeners a clue as to where they can read and hear, you know, see more stuff about you?
Yes, I can say this. I've been writing 15 straight years. 3 books on TMS and I'm burned out. I am so burned out on writing about it that it's time to start lecturing more. Mm-hmm. You know, I need to take it to the people. And so I wanted to get the products out there so that they had something to have in their hands and to read and understand. But I'm also working on a training video, of course. But I think as far as books right now, I think I've got one more in me, hopefully later. You know, about maybe not on this topic, probably about life and love and happiness or something like that and manifesting what you want in your life. For now, I think I'm actually working on my audiobooks right now because there's great requests for those. Mm-hmm. And once the audio's done, I'll definitely start lecturing probably in summer to fall. And they can always find me at steveozanich.com, of course. And I'm on Amazon, and my videos, as you said, are on YouTube. There'll probably be thousands. I want to build that wall so big of people who have healed, just thousands of people, so that nobody can ignore it. And so as long as, you know, God willing, as long as I'm here, I will keep spreading this message because it saved my life, and I want to give the gift away. To whom much is given, much will be asked. And I was given the world. And so I really want to help as many people as I can. And if anybody listening here wants to know more, they can contact me.
www.steveozanich.com. And of course, also, you go onto YouTube, you do a search on your name, it comes back with 433 results. So you are quite popular on YouTube.
Yeah, so I'm hoping to help as many people as I can. It's the most rewarding thing I've ever done. And so once again, you know, thank you so much for allowing me the chance to actually talk, you know, and express it. And there's a lot more that needs to be said, too. And of course, time is so much in our lives. And people want the quick fix, of course, because they want that pill. You know, give me the pill. I've got a chemical imbalance. But the chemicals in the body are only imbalanced because of the emotions. Mm-hmm. And so that is really the heart of it, you know, in your work here. On emotions. We are emotional beings, like it or not. You know, but we tend to repress what we do not like. The eye see what only what it wants to see. It's called scotoma. And the rest of it blocks and does it via the ego. If the ego doesn't like what it sees, it's threatening to superego, it just blocks it. And so the psychology gets very complicated behind it, but the healing does not have to be really. People can simply get the books and read them over and over and over and heal. And if they can't, then contact me.
Well, Steve, thank you so very much for being with us today. We really appreciate your time.
Thank you, John.
This is John, and I look forward to you joining me on the next episode of the Emotions Matter podcast.